Hello, lovely people, and welcome to today's Chrissy B Show. Now, is there an area of your life where you lack confidence? Perhaps it's at work or the way you look. Or maybe you're quite a confident person, but you'd like to improve a bit more, or maybe you're just not confident as a whole. So today we're going to be actually helping those at home that maybe don't feel so good about themselves. We've got a really good real life story that we're going to be sharing with you later. But first, let's read a few tweets. So we have Sacklap who says, a girl's most beautiful outfit ever is charisma. The prettiest accessory is a smile. And the best pair of heels is confidence. And we've got Joe who says, I will never lose confidence. Confidence is who I am. So it's great that there are people out there who are confident. Naomi says, Twitter has made me smarter and gave me the confidence to speak up. I've made like-minded friends and gained confidence. It's not just Twitter. And Think Reese says, confidence isn't walking into a room with your nose in the air. It's walking into a room and not having to compare yourself to anyone. I really love that one. And we have Davina who says, sit at the front, speak up, stand tall, exercise, dress to impress, waitressing helped me build confidence. Right, so let's see who we have on today's lineup. So we have Emma Rule, who'll be sharing her life story of how she gained her confidence later on in life, which led her to having a very successful career. And also we have our resident coach, Chris Browne, teaching us how to show the best version of ourselves at work and also how to get noticed for the right reason. Plus we have the Gregoire sisters in full force to help you with your wardrobe and makeup tips. And we'll both be working on our makeover model for tonight, Sehar Zaman. And last but certainly not least, I'll be sharing with you my 5 ways of staying confident. But let's first of all meet our model and of course say hello to our lovely makeup artist. Hello, ladies.
Hello.
How are you?
Good, thank you.
Good.
So it's good to have you both. So how are you going to be having your makeup done?
But yes.
In general, would you describe yourself as a confident person?
Yeah, I usually am a confident person, but whenever I'm not, I sort of put on a facade and trick myself into thinking I am.
Okay.
So, like, if I don't feel confident about something, I sort of, in my mind, I'm like, oh yeah, I can do this, I've got this, you're fine.
Okay.
So
you have to kind of psych yourself up.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay. Was there any stage in your life when you weren't so confident about yourself?
Yeah, of course. I mean, there are many moments when I'm not, but like I said, I just use that trick, and it helps me.
So. Okay. So another trick, obviously, that we use is the makeup, right? Mm. Girls in general, and even guys that do their grooming. Mm. So obviously, makeup does make you feel a bit more confident about yourself. But what kind of stuff were you thinking of doing on Sehar today?
Well, I just wanted to talk about really that it's the application of makeup that can make you confident, because actually applying makeup wrong could actually have that adverse effect and probably bring less confidence or maybe some negative, I guess, reactions rather than what you're going for. So it's about being confident in your skin. Mm-hmm. And so that's choosing the right products and applying products that are actually complementary in a complementary way. So I'm going to do that with Sehar today.
Okay, lovely. All right, so girls, we're going to let you get on with it. And in the meantime, let's go to the news with the lovely Excel. Hello to the very confident Excel.
Chrissy B, you know me very well. Not. No, well, generally.
You are. Yeah. I know you.
Well. Well, something interesting I have to say I had to find based on this news tonight was about celebrities before they were famous. I think that's quite apt for confidence before and after. I've sort of pulled up a few celebrities that we know very well, and I thought it was quite interesting what I found out about them. So these are all what they all did before they were famous, before they became famous. So the first on my list is Brad Pitt. Of course, we know Brad. Mm. He was 2 credits shy of graduating from the University of Missouri with a degree in journalism when he dropped out and moved to LA. During his pursuit of stardom, he delivered refrigerators, he drove exotic dancers around in a limousine, and he wore a chicken suit
and danced
around for El Polo Loco.
No, he did not.
Oh, yes, he did. You heard it here first on Chrissy B Show. I have to say, it was absolutely interesting, some of the things I found out. Second person, Kanye West. We all know our Kanye. During his high school days, he folded clothes at the Gap. Yeah. And he actually had an album called The College Dropout, in which he mentions his former retail job, and the lyrics go, let's go back, I'm not gonna try and sing it, by the way. Let's go back to the Gap. Look at my check, wasn't no scratch. So if I stole, wasn't my fault. Yeah, I stole, never got caught.
Oh dear.
You've been caught now, Kanye. Think about all those percentages and the things you stole, you're gonna be paying back. On to the next person. We know Johnny Depp from the Pirate of the Caribbean series. He was a telemarketer and he sold pens, and he recalls, I was selling pens and you call people who don't want you to call them. You put on your best fake voice and try and sell them a gross or two of ballpoint pens with their names printed on them. First, you say, congratulations, you have just become eligible to win a grandfather clock or a trip to Greece or a jacuzzi or whatever. So, I mean, telemarketers, we kind of really...
Just cut them off. Oh.
I think you definitely have to have oodles and oodles of confidence to be a telemarketer. Because oftentimes...
Because people are so horrible to them.
Yeah, because oftentimes people never go, oh, yeah, hello, telemarketer, I'm so glad to hear from you.
I don't really have anyone calling me anymore. I just have those irritating automated messages.
Yeah, I think that's the way. That's the way they've replaced people.
When I don't recognize a number, I just listen. And as soon as there's a silence or whatever, and I know the recording's going to start, I just put it down straight away. It's so annoying.
In fact, somebody called me one time and said, "This call is about the accident you had." And I'm thinking, "Say what? Is there a parallel universe? Because I've never had a no accident. Thank you very much. Hang up." So you know, sometimes it can be quite generic and off-putting. But I suppose you know you have to kind of sell things one way or another. Well, yeah, definitely need oodles of confidence to be a telemarketer. Madonna is another one who, prior to her iconic appearance in 1984 in American Bandstand, she worked as a showgirl in France. And she also worked at a Dunkin' Donuts in New York's Times Square, where she was allegedly fired because she squirted jelly filling all over a customer.
Oh.
Oopsie-daisy.
That doesn't surprise me at all.
Okay, the next person is Gerard Butler, another actor we know and love. A year after graduating from law school, he took up a job at a law firm, but his desire to act became too much for him, and he quit his law career to become a casting assistant, where he then landed his first role as a lead in a movie called Coriolanus. Sounds like Roman Empire thing or something. But yeah, so quick okay. Talk about following passion there. Ashton Kutcher is another one. We know him from the Punked series. He studied biomedical engiering.
Really?
Sounds very intelligent for, you know, I'm sorry, but he's quite an intelligent
man. Be careful, please. Don't want to get sued here.
We love Ashton.
Yeah.
I've just punked you. He studied biomedical engineering at the University of Iowa. Before he dropped out of college to pursue his modeling career, he swept cereal dust at a General Mills factory to help with his living expenses. Oh, I mean, who is that? Who has such a specific job description? You will sweep cereal dust. But anyway, apparently he also sold his blood for extra cash.
Oh,
Well, as in blood banks, I suppose.
Yes.
But I never thought you could get money for that. But anyway.
Of course.
Yeah, I never
heard of it before.
I mean, we don't hear. I mean, only in America as usual.
No, over here.
Really?
Yes.
I'd never realised
that.
Oh,
no, hang on, it wasn't selling your blood. No, it wasn't. Let me correct myself. No, it was there's medical experiments.
Yeah, that's different. Yes. But
I'm sorry, off the point. Let's go back to something else.
Indeed. Well, George Clooney is another one who, at the age of 16, he tried out for the Cincinnati Reds baseball team. He did not get a contract, but he decided to go to college to become a broadcast journalist. And after dropping out of school, he held many odd jobs, including a shoe salesman and tobacco farmhand, before moving to LA.
Ooh.
Oh, who knew? Sandra Bullock is another one. She, during the early stages of her career, she supported herself by working as a waitress and a bartender in New York. John Bon Jovi is another one who sold newspapers as a youngster, and after high school, he worked as a janitor at his cousin's recording studio, where he then recorded his first single, Runaway, at the age of 18.
Oh, so.
Absolutely. Oh, of course, I couldn't miss this out. Jennifer Aniston is another one. Jennifer, who's Rachel on Friends, as we know and love. She worked also as a telemarketer And she was also a waitress and a bike messenger. And she also appeared on a talk show as a spokesmodel.
It's funny how she was a waitress in real life and then she played the waitress in Friends.
Exactly, exactly.
Although, according to the tweet we had earlier, waitressing, you have to interact with customers.
Because you do have to talk to a lot of people. You have to make friends. And so if you're kind of shy, retiring wallflower, that's not really a job for you because you won't get tips.
Yeah, oh, that's true, the tips as well, but you need to kind of be ready for anything as well as a waitress.
Absolutely, absolutely. I like hamburger with no ham and no burger. How do you deal with that?
Yeah.
Well,
one more, I think.
One more? Okay.
Pick a good one.
Okay, I shall pick Walt Disney. Before he won any of his 22 Academy Awards, he had many odd jobs, including a paperboy. He also worked for the railroad, selling traveler snacks and magazines. And when he was rejected by the army, he joined the Red Cross and drove an ambulance in France at the end of World War I.
Okay. I was hoping you'd talk about one of the other ones, actually, like Sean Connery or Hugh Grant or Mariah Carey, but we haven't got time. Thank you very much, Excel.
Indeed.
I'll have a look at that later, though. Mm-hmm. Sorry, guys, to keep you in suspense. All right, guys, so after the break, I'll be joined by our special guest tonight, Emma Rule, who'll be sharing her experience of self-confidence right here on The Chrissy B Show. And later on, I'll also be sharing my 5 ways that I keep myself confident. So don't go away. Hi, I'm Chrissy B and my show is all about improving your mental health and being happy. Join me every Monday, Wednesday and Friday at 10 p.m. on my channel Sky 203. Visit chrissybshow.tv for more information and subscribe to our YouTube channel Chrissy B Show. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Chrissy B Show and on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. Welcome back, everyone. And if you've just joined us, today's show is all about how to be confident. And now we're very lucky to be joined by Emma Rule. Hello, Emma.
Hi, Chrissy. Thank you for having me.
It's lovely to have you here because you've actually got quite a story, haven't you?
Yeah, interesting. Yeah. Ever-changing.
So obviously you describe yourself as confident today, but there was a time in your life where you weren't confident. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, absolutely. I wasn't particularly confident growing up. I think I'd say I was quite an awkward child. I never really thought that I fitted in. You know, I was always thinking, I think I'm a little bit different. Mm-hmm. But then I think children do that anyway. I think you come to an age where you think you become self-aware and you compare yourself to other people. And I think it really hit me at one point and I just thought, I don't quite know where I belong here in this kind of setup, and
which is quite a scary thing for a child, isn't it?
Yeah, well, absolutely. And I think actually I became quite bulky and probably appeared quite brave, and that was kind of the way I dealt with.
But you didn't feel that way. You were just portraying that just to kind of defend yourself in a way, kind of protect yourself.
Absolutely. It was a defence really, and trying to hide it. And I've always been quite good at hiding it, so I've been through some traumas in my life and times that really have knocked me, and I've never wanted anyone to know or spoken about it. And so it's quite nice to come here today, actually, to kind of come full circle and actually say, okay, and share it.
All right. So then, what happened after that? Growing up, okay, you had quite a hard time at school and everything. What happened after that?
I became a bit of a bad girl, really. I used to drink quite a lot, smoked, got into trouble. Not bad trouble, but, you know, I was a bit of a trouble causer. A bit of a bully, nothing serious. But again, I think that was the way I wanted attention, and I always looked for it in the wrong way. So I'd look to find friends through trying to impress them in the wrong way. Right. To try and fit in somewhere. And I'd think, where do I fit? Do I fit with the bad crowd or,
you know? You're just trying to find yourself at the time, weren't you, I suppose?
And I really didn't have any sort of direction and I was never sure who I was. And I was also a real tomboy and I didn't like girly things. So I found it hard to fit with the girls, and I didn't quite fit in with the boys.
Yes, another confusing stage.
I spent quite a lot of time on my own, or up a tree, I used to like climbing trees.
And that was like me.
I
understand you, don't worry.
But I'm still like that, actually. Yeah. I'm still quite a loner now, actually. Yeah. But now I quite enjoy that.
Okay. So. Now, you did end up meeting a young man. Can you tell us about that?
I did. I met my husband. He was really struggling in life. He had taken drugs for quite a long time. He'd been through some quite big traumas himself. We met, and when we first met, he tried to chat me up, not very well. And he'd asked me out, and I thought, I'm not going out with you. You're a drug-taking loser, and you know. And he persisted with asking me out. And in the end, I said, okay, we'll go out. But I'm telling you now, I'm just going out because you're going to buy me a meal. I don't want anything to do with
it. That's very honest of you.
I was still this hard person, you see, then. And we went out and spoke, and I learnt a little bit about his life, and I thought I could help you. I don't know why, I just felt a connection to him. Mm. And I think that was the start of quite a change.
So did that kind of, even the fact that he approached you and was so persistent in asking you out, would you say that kind of boosted your confidence?
Yes, because I hadn't had that attention. I hadn't had someone say, but I really like you, please come and spend time with me. And and also I think as the relationship went on, and through his difficulties, the fact that he trusted me and had confidence in me gave me confidence to help him. So
I mean, it is important, when other people around you do believe in you, if you don't sort of get that from family members, but there are, because I know there's people watching that say, well, I've got no one that believes in me and my family, I've been through so many family issues, but there are other people around. That's why, for example, we're doing the show today, because we believe in you. That's why we're here sharing things, isn't it? So, there's always someone that does care and, is backing you. Backing you up.
That's it. And you build your own confidence through giving other people confidence. Mm-hmm. It really is a two-way, a two-way thing, I think. And now, I get the payback because now he's my rock and the confidence behind me. So
that's lovely.
It's a nice,
Now we could actually spend this whole segment talking about your relationship, but we need to go into your career now. You've done something remarkable, haven't you? Tell us about that.
I've got a few things going on at the moment. I had a complete career change about 3 years ago. Mm-hmm. I decided I was getting more and more confident in life. I enjoyed my job. I was a carer. Mm-hmm. I've always looked after people, and that requires a level of confidence. And I realised that I had other talents. I wasn't quite sure. I couldn't pin down exactly what it was, but I knew I was good with people. I knew I enjoyed working around people, and that I was good encouraging other people and bringing the best out of people, which probably came again back to my husband originally. So I started a PR company, and I worked with various celebrities, bands, people in the media. I put stories into newspapers.
That's quite a big transition, isn't it?
Yes.
From how you grew up and how you felt about yourself to now, because obviously PR, you have to be out there and you have to be confident.
You absolutely do. And with PR and the clients I work with, they have to have so much confidence in me because I take a client, and it's not just a case of putting something in a newspaper. It's actually guiding people or raising their profile. And it's asking other people to invest in them. I'm trying to sell this person to someone. This person's fabulous because da 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 da. So then I need to be, people need to trust me. People at newspapers need to trust me. If I'm saying this is a fantastic story because this person's about to become a huge celebrity, they're fantastic. Yeah. I need those people to believe me, and that takes confidence.
Mm-hmm. How do you feel when you look back at your life and you see how far you've come?
I still can't believe it each day because it's escalating all the time. Mm-hmm. I'm off into all sorts of different areas. People ask me to work for them all the time. I've got more work than I can take.
Wow.
And I feel very lucky that people can see that skill in me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm surprised. I surprise myself all the time, but also I'm still challenging myself, so I'm still always looking for the next thing to do.
This is the thing, because sometimes, and I'll be talking about more of this later on, but people kind of think that confidence will just come, and it doesn't. You have to actually step out there and try different things and talk to people and push yourself,
absolutely.
Even when you feel really uncomfortable.
Yeah, and it's not all come through work. I do a couple of other things. I work at crisis over Christmas in the night shelters.
Okay,
that's given me huge amounts of confidence, mm-hmm. to be able to walk into the first time I went into a situation, I had no idea, no training, I didn't know what I'd face in there. And it actually makes my Christmas now that I can spend time with people that otherwise, you know, couldn't be looked after like that, and the facilities they have there, and to give those people confidence and also get it back again.
So that's a really nice thing to say, actually, because you won't sort of think, oh, I need more confidence, let me go and do some charity work. It two don't seem to match, but it makes perfect sense,
doesn't it?
No, because you're there interacting with people and like...
Absolutely,
yeah,
and
helping.
you have to forget yourself.
Mm.
So you go in there and it's not about yourself, it's about the people you're talking to and their lives and what you can give to them, you know. And
that's lovely.
And I think that's a great thing to say about confidence, that sometimes take yourself out of the equation. Don't focus
on you,
on yourself, focus on the, you know, the person you're with, listen.
Yeah.
To the person, you know.
Okay. So, Emil, future plans for yourself?
Future plans. I've just produced 2 pilots for TV, which is, again, something else new with the production company. So they've gone off to be looked at by
Brilliant.
A couple of channels. So hopefully that's going to go.
Yeah.
I'm working with some fantastic people at the moment, quite a few musicians. An amazing band from Manchester called Alias Kid. I'll just get that in.
Right.
Lovely guys. So they're doing really well at the moment.
Right.
I got a business partner, Gary Bushell, who quite a lot of people might know. Mm-hmm. He's a newspaper columnist and celebrity from the TV. And he actually is somebody who probably gives me the most confidence out of anyone, apart from a husband, because he... I work with him very closely, and every day I'll go on, get on with it, you can do it, kind of stop messing about. So
you're not stopping here, you're just like still developing.
Absolutely,
still
I feel like I've only just started, and although I've done an awful lot over the last 2 or 3 years, I think there's quite a lot more to come.
Brilliant.
And
I think so too.
And I'd really like to take some people places with me. That's what I'd like to do.
I'm sure you will. Emma, thank you so much for sharing your story and all the best for the future.
Thank
I'm
you.
Sure it's going to be a very bright one.
Thank you. Thanks
thank
for having
you.
Me.
All right, guys, so don't go away, because after this quick break, we'll have our makeover reveal. And later on, I'll be sharing my own 5 ways how I stay confident. So we'll be right back. Hi, I'm Chrissy B, and my show is all about improving your mental health and being happy. Join me every Monday, Wednesday and Friday at 10 p.m. on my channel Sky 203. Visit chrissybshow.tv for more information and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Chrissy B Show. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Chrissy B Show and on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. Welcome back, everybody. So now it's time for our makeover reveal. As you know, this program today is all about being more confident. So let's take a look at the work that Megan's done right now. Hello, ladies.
Hiya.
So lovely makeup. Megan, tell us what you've done here.
Well, first, I asked her what she felt comfortable with mm-hmm. and kind of some of the things that she likes. And obviously, we went with something that she was confident with, but kind of just enhanced it. I'm also going to bring in some tips that will make others, okay. the viewers, confident in terms of some okay. things that maybe they won't be as confident with. And how to achieve this look really with very pigmented colors, mm-hmm. which Zahar loves. She's about color. She said that, you know, usually what I do is a bright lip. So one of the things that can go wrong with a bright lip is, you know, people are worried about the liner and it seeping out. But how about you get a very, you know, pigmented color, such as a very bright pink, mm-hmm. and dab it on your finger, just warm it up and blend it in to the lip. And so then you don't have to worry about not being confident. Is it seeping out of the line? You know, is it, you know, going on my chin? It's actually just staying right there on yeah. your lip, and it's giving it a lovely stain of pigment. Now, with blusher, you could actually go wrong. And I guess confidence, some people, you know, like to have that flush and that, mm-hmm. you know, that bright look or that contoured look. But sometimes it goes wrong because the positioning of the product is wrong.
Right.
So,
okay.
you know, you can be confident knowing that where you actually blush is in the apples of the cheeks. So with especially a pigmented blush, you can start there and you can work your way up. And it is about kind of just pressing it lightly. You know, take a look at yourself. You ran up a flight of stairs. You're getting a bit hot. Where is that flush coming? And you can see actually where it naturally mm-hmm. comes from. And that's what you want to achieve with makeup, is that natural beauty look. You know, and one of the things that people go wrong with is that when they're doing things that they love, like Sahar, you said you love the liner, you're very confident with the wing.
Yeah.
We've asked Sahar this, but also what you want to make sure is when you're with the liner, that you're doing something that's complementary, which means that, you know, you're not leaving the fleshy bits that are going to have that adverse effect. Just close your eyes. So, you know, when you're doing a liner, because you love to have that kind of wing line, try not to go as far out initially with the black liner and look to just follow naturally the lash line, because it's easier to kind of clean up with a precision tip Q-tip mm-hmm. as opposed to kind of have to wipe everything off because yeah. you've already applied your lovely eyeshadow and such. So, you know, too strong a blusher. Another thing is going wrong with putting too much product on, and I always kind of mention this in the segment, is that, mm-hmm. you know, obviously, Sahar said, you know, sometimes she lacks confidence in terms of some of the texture on her skin. So, you know, it's about getting the base right. So we have, you know, a Pro Balm, which retexturizes by Bare Minerals, and it's, you know, basically about getting that base right. So if you yeah. have some, you know, areas that you would like to have retexturized, get a nice primer, and then that way you don't have to be excessive with the product you're using. Mm-hmm. And by product, I mean foundation, and okay. choose the right color,
yeah.
because that also can, you know, turn out to be quite disastrous. So, you know, we have, you know, a number of colors that obviously different shades. This is, you know, I can do, you know, anyone with this palette in terms of mm-hmm. colors. It's just a visual. Make sure to ask a professional if you're not confident in yeah. your choices, because they'll tell you, you know, they'll be working with products at the counter mm-hmm. and they'll be knowledgeable looking at you, what your skin tone is.
Yeah, okay. And just finally, what do you think of the makeup look for today?
I absolutely love it.
Yeah.
I mean,
it looks lovely.
Spot on, yeah, definitely. I love the lips, definitely.
Yeah, nice bright, really
yeah.
nice.
Okay. Very much suits her, and she's right. beautiful as well. So.
Megan, thank you so much.
Thank
so
you.
Now we're gonna go over to Cynthia with the styling. So she's here watching patiently for us. Hi, Cynthia.
Hi, Chrissy.
How are you doing?
Good, how are you doing?
I'm good, thank you.
Good.
So confidence with clothing, what would you say?
Right, well, with confidence in clothing, the first thing I'm gonna say is that you have to be comfortable with what you're wearing. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's nothing worse than forcing yourself into a style that you're not comfortable with, and you just seem very self-conscious
yes.
of it. So I consulted with Sahar before we did the makeover, and again, she told me about the bright colors and her love of bright colors, so I thought, great. Because you can't just, you know, forcefully put this on someone who would wear black all the time or something like that. Yeah. It just wouldn't be comfortable. So I just go through her outfit, which she carries off so well. She's got the right confidence for this outfit. I'll just start with her shoes. She got some Sam Edelman pony skin shoes with a snake skin detail on the back. And I've paired them with Helmut Lang elasticized trousers that look like leather, and they give that kind of wet look. And I'll let her tell you what she thinks of them herself. And then we've also tucked in a very bright silk blouse by DVF, and she just does those bright colors so well. And we tucked it in because she was feeling confident with her yeah. fabulous body. So, Sahara, tell us about the outfit and what you think about it.
I absolutely love it. At first, I thought, oh no, when I saw it, this was going to be out, but I actually like it tucked in. It sort of gives me a shape, which I really like. And although they probably look like they're really tight and painful, but they're actually so comfortable. That's why I love it. I love the snake skin. I probably wish that the shoes were probably red to match that, but other than that, amazing.
And right, you could change up the shoes and do anything that you want with it, right? That is obviously not enough color for Sahara, so she wants to up the color a little bit.
That's great, the right shoes.
And absolutely, and I think she would pull it off great. So thanks, Sahara, for letting me redo you. And I just want to say about Chrissy, I mean, when we talk about confidence, Chrissy has so much confidence in me every week, and I love it because she pretty much lets me put her
anything
in
on
all different styles, and she doesn't really ask me what I'm bringing for her every week. So I would just like to point out Chrissy's lovely Rebecca Taylor jumpsuit. She wears a jumpsuit very well, and I mean, not all women have a jumpsuit in their wardrobe just because the confidence is not there to wear the full piece. But I love styling you, and I always say that because you have such confidence in my picks, which is great for me. My sister is a lover of lace, and that is her look that she looks comfortable in, and I think she does this DVF dress, Autumn Winter 15, just absolutely gorgeous. So, I mean, if you're feeling it, you know, it shows kind of thing. So, and how are the shoes for you, Megan? I saw those and I thought of you. What do you think?
Yeah, I absolutely love them. The detailing is immaculate, and you know that that's something that I'm attracted to as well. And I am confident wearing lace, and I just think it's like timeless. It's very sophisticated, and it suits really who
You are. Yeah. I agree. And that's what I mean, Chrissy. Like, if we're confident in what we're wearing and comfortable in our own style, it shows through from the inside. So I'd like to make that point as well. Correct sizing is so important. I mean, there's nothing worse than a low-riding jean that's a little too low, or, you know, heels that you're teeter-tottering in because there's a size too small, or a crop top, you know. Be very comfortable in your sizing. And I know that some of us love to, you know, say that we fit the double XS, but extra small, but I mean, it's what fits you. Yeah. And I think that my final point is that bodies come in all shapes, colors, and sizes. And the size that you are now might not be the size that you are later on in life due to having children or surgeries or excessive weight loss, gain, accidents such as I had myself. Mm-hmm. And I mean, it's about loving your body and being comfortable in the skin that you're in. And I mean, that beauty will shine through.
That's definitely so. Now, we've also got some stuff on the rail because, you know, we can't ignore those things because there's some pretty nice pieces on there, I have to say.
Well, we just came off of London Fashion Week, right? So I just wanted to share a little bit about what I was seeing on the catwalk. Myself and Megan, we had attended some shows there, and we brought back some of the looks. So mine is one of the looks that I'm seeing this season is, again, that timeless monochrome. And I know I've done a segment or two on monochrome, and that's just the black and the white.
It just keeps coming back, doesn't it?
It does, yeah. So hopefully you're catching on that this is a very classic, very easy look. If you're not sure what you're comfortable with, you can't really go wrong with black and white. And I've just put them with, you know, a pop of color on the shoes. Red shoes, I mean, you know, we're not all about just black and white and neutral colors. Obviously, you can wear color in autumn, winter as well. Some things that I'm seeing that are still really hot on the high street are the fur gilets. So you can layer these on top of jackets and, you know, shirts, anything even like this. Mix your textures. Chrissy, I know you were a lover of
these. Oh, yeah, I love them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. A lot of detail in the neck. This Vivienne Westwood shirt has the tie around the neck, and you can see a lot of the pretty details around the neck for this autumn winter season. We are going to see a lot of leopard print. This is kind of one of those trends that are always kind of in, but look for it in your different, you know, there's shoes, there's shorts, you know, you got your top, you could do a bag, you could do accessories. I'm still a lover of the going back into a different decade. So we've got the monochrome 60s vintage, that's nice. You know, for those of you who like vintage. Check out what your favorite designers are doing, you know, for the season. We have this simple A-line shaped dress, which is so easy to wear as well if you're not sure what you're comfortable in and would like to try, you know, a dress.
Yeah.
Lots of fringe, still gonna see lots of fringe.
I love those.
This one's a beautiful jacket. This one here is two things I wanna point out. First of all, that it's suede. Suede is very in right now. The fringe as well, and then you've also got the crop. So it means it's gonna be a little shorter in here, so you wanna make sure that your shirt, you know, is low enough or, mm-hmm. you know, that you're comfortable, really. Again, just another sort of like velvety sort of texture, suede texture, and that's just a black jacket to play around with your white shirt.
And we have managed to get through everything. That's amazing. Ladies, thank you so, so much, all of you, for participating. It's been really great advice from the two lovely sisters as well. Thank you as well.
Thank you.
No problem. All right, guys, so we have reached the end of this segment, but after the break, I'm going to be joined by our resident guest, Coach Chris Browne, and he's going to be talking about how to get noticed at work. And I'll also be sharing five things that I do and think to stay confident. See you in just a second. Hi, I'm Chrissy B, and my show is all about improving your mental health and being happy. Join me every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 10 p.m. on my channel, Sky 203. Visit chrissybshow.tv for more information and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Chrissy B Show. You can also follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Chrissy B Show and on our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. So now, everybody, we're joined by Coach Chris Browne to talk to us about how to have more confidence at work and also to stand out. How are you, Chris?
I'm great, Chrissy. How are you doing?
I'm very well, thank you.
Yeah. Listen, you're talking about standing out at work, and we do that every day in one way or another. But the main thing, if somebody's actually looking personally how to stand out at work, mm-hmm. I'd say learn as much as you can learn. Everything okay. about the job, that's one area, right? So the knowledge, making yourself an asset to the company is really important. Mm-hmm. Here's the other one, be a team player, right? It's not all about you and just you trying to get that task done, trying to beat the person next to you or anything like that. No, it's being a team player, be inclusive of everything, bring some ideas to the table as well, mm-hmm. right? right, bring some ideas to the table, right? Also, on top of that, how you present yourself. How you present yourself is really important because you actually represent the company itself. So think about this. They need somebody to go out there at a meeting and represent them. They're not going to pick the person who's most scruffiest, who doesn't watch their P's and Q's, who doesn't reflect the company. They want to send somebody out there who says, hey, I'm really happy with that one, you know, and get good feedback about them as well. So it's really important. And when we say standing out, I'm going to keep saying it. Not to be in competition with your colleagues. Work with your colleagues. Somebody messed up, help them out to get along the way. These are the people who are going to help you when you mess up too at the same time. So this really helps for standing out and being one of the players in the company.
I think so maybe sometimes people get the kind of wrong impression of how to stand out and they think, right. I've got to be the best one out of everybody. I've got to really show who I am and that I'm this confident person, even though maybe they don't feel that confident.
Right.
And they kind of, it ends up working against them, kind of they shoot themselves in the foot, don't they?
Yes.
Because it's not about it, like you're saying, it's simple things. It's like, I would say, honourable things to do.
Right.
In most cases, like, you know, being a team player and finding out about the company, representing the company well.
Yeah.
It's not about showing off, as some people might do.
Not at all. Yeah. Nobody really likes a show off at the end of the day, do they? And let's put it this way, you start showing off, like you're going to get the daggers coming out of your back. You know, the little whispering, little gossip, this sort of thing. And you think, well, what am I doing at the end of the day? You know what? You know what you're doing at the end of the day. And it's either right down side, you've either got to be the player or you're playing against the players one way or another. Be the player. It will push you in the right direction. Mm-hmm. And then again, you might have brilliant ideas that could take that company to a total another level.
Yeah.
That would be great. That would be the person, if I was working in a company, that I would pick out. I'd observe them, see how they interact with others, what have you got to offer, what do they know, and that's the person I'd actually look at for.
I mean, you can sort of tell, can't you, from the person that's there just doing their job, they're there 9 to 5, and they're not really thinking about the job outside of work. It's just there to get the salary, and that's it, they're out. Those that actually take the time to think and to come up with ideas. Normally, those people will kind of think of those ideas maybe when they're away from work, they're out and about, maybe relaxing, and that ideas tend to come. So it shows that that person cares about the company as well.
That's it.
And the job itself, not just the job itself, and they're, you know, they're developing ideas.
Completely.
So of course you want to, that person will stand out.
They'll
rather
stand
than
out.
Someone that's just there clocking in and out and that's it.
Exactly, and you just mentioned something. People who do exactly what they get paid for, that's all they'll ever get at the end of the day. People who do the extra more will get paid more at the end of the day and will rise. Cream always rises to the top. And sometimes we see we're not being promoted and we think, oh, it must be this or it must be that or it must be somebody else or, all that sort of thing. But you've got to stop, reflect, look at what you're doing, see what others are doing, what could you do better? How can you improve yourself for that company at the end of the day? Now, saying that, you've got to be aware of your own self-confidence as well, because sometimes we might not know how to fulfill a certain task. Why pretend that you know how to do it? Ask someone, get help, build your self-esteem up, build your confidence up, interact, expose yourself.
That is actually a very good point, because again, someone that actually speaks up when they need help, or it kind of shows that you can trust them.
Yes.
Because there are people that maybe you're going through such a hard time at work and you think, oh, I'm not going to say anything because then I'm going to be seen as weak. But and then this big bomb explodes.
Exactly.
something really major goes wrong because you didn't speak up and talk about it. It's not a weakness. Obviously, if you've tried your best and you've done everything that you can and it's not working out and there's some, you need some guidance.
Yes.
I love it when people come to me and ask for, you know, an idea, or they're going through. I like it. I don't like it when people hide things from me and say everything's okay and then it's not. And then I go to see the work and it's like a load of rubbish. It's not going well.
Exactly, exactly.
I appreciate people's honesty. And I think that stands out for me.
And you just said that because automatically you trust someone more like that, who's willing to just open up themselves and say, I don't know how to do this. Or not that they don't know how to do it, just leave it there. I want help on this.
Exactly.
You know, to expose yourself is a good thing. You'll get trust. And we're human. We're human. Yeah. If you walked into the company and you knew how to do everything, then, hey, start running your own company.
Yeah.
You know, that's what you should be doing.
That's true. All right, Chris, thank you so much.
Pleasure,
Chrissy. See you again next time.
Yeah. Okay.
All right, guys, so now it's time to go to my tips on how I keep myself confident. All right, everybody, so let's go straight to the things that I do to stay confident. So the first one is, I'm grateful. So I'm very thankful for all the things that I have in my life, such as my faith, my husband, my friends and family, and of course this show. So there are plenty of things, you know, that I have that I can look at and say, you know, I've got so many good things going on for me. And that does give me confidence. So you need to kind of check your life and see, what do you have that you are grateful for? So there's people obviously in the world that have nowhere near what you do. So you've got a good foundation to work from. And all you have to do now is fight for more. So that actually takes me on to my second point, which is challenge yourself. So as I was saying from the first point, it doesn't mean because there are things that you should be grateful for in your life, but there's other stuff that's very bad that you should just accept life the way it is. Yes, you're grateful for the things that you have already, but you also fight for, you know, go for bigger things in your life as well. So challenging yourself can actually get you there. So it does feel really safe and warm to be in your comfort zone. It is like a warm bed on a winter's day. But comfort zones are very dangerous places. Why? Because you can actually be stuck there for ages. And if you don't do anything differently, if you just stay stuck in that comfort zone, life actually does get pretty boring. Nothing different happens and you end up feeling that you're not achieving much at all. So with myself, I do aim to step out with different things. So it could be something small like a new hairstyle or a new type of clothing. It could be a new project at work. But when you do actually go for something new and you go out of your normal routine, you do feel so good about yourself afterwards. The third point is, don't be afraid to fail. Now, I have this attitude, if I try something and it doesn't work, so what? I tried. So there was something recently, actually, I wanted to try something. I had an idea for some new kind of filming. It was secret filming. That you may have watched. It was the suicide show that we did, suicide prevention. And in my head was like, oh, I'd really like to try something different. Instead of doing our normal street chats, let's try and, you know, do some acting and see how the public reacts. And those thoughts came like, oh, it could go drastically wrong. People might get really upset when they find out it's not actually real what you're doing and it's just a social experiment. And what if someone calls the police because they really think someone's going to jump? All these kind of thoughts came to my mind. And I thought, but you know what? I talk about doing new things all the time on the show. I need to also practice that. And it's something that I do try to do. So I thought, let's just try it. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work. At least we tried. So on the actual day when we went to do the filming, everything worked out so well. The footage was really good. We had some great feedback. So I think it's really important that we do try things, even if there's a possibility of failure, but at least you know. So next time you could try and do it differently or not do that particular thing at all. But it does also help me gain confidence in the work that I do as well as in myself. The fourth point is surround yourself with positive people. So I read somewhere that your outlook, negative or positive, will be the average of the five people you spend the most time with. So that, I think that's self-explanatory. I don't need to talk more about that point. And also number five is research and prepare. So in most cases for me, I do like to prepare well. So when I know what I'm going to be talking about, I know background about things, it makes me feel more confident. And that's to do with anything as well. So we have so many resources nowadays, so there's no excuse really for not researching and not finding out the things that you need to for work or for anything else for that matter. So, you know, you've got the internet, you've got so many things that you can refer to. All right, so that's some of the ways that I keep myself confident. Now, if you guys at home do have something that you'd like to see us covering on this show, please do get in touch via our website, chrissybshow.tv. You can also tweet at Chrissy B Show, and also you can visit our Facebook page, The Chrissy B Show. Well, that's all we have time for today, but if you also have a story to tell us, you can visit the website and send the form from there, chrissybshow.tv. And if you'd like to know more about how I overcame depression and panic attacks and other mental health issues, you can head over to my personal website, mylifeafterdepression.com. See you again next time. Bye-bye for now.